Father, today we come to you in the mighty name of Jesus. Lord, we're grateful for your presence already in this place. God, what a joy it is to sing to you and to worship you, to lift our hearts and our hands, to lift our voices, God, with your praise and your glory, God. You are good and your mercy endures forever. Today, God, as we open up your word, we pray that you open it up to us. Open us up to receive it. Open our eyes to see, our ears to hear, our hearts to have a good understanding. May we be the good ground where the word is sown, and may it produce something in each and every one of our individual lives. Today, God, we don't look to a man or to a woman, to the young or the old, the black, the white, the brown, any other color we could imagine. We look to you. Holy Spirit, you are the teacher of the church. Be welcome in this place. Be our teacher. Be our guide. Give us the vision, the wisdom, the instruction, the direction, even the correction we need for our lives. The Lord will give you the praise and the glory and the honor for it. God, we don't just ask this blessing for ourselves. Also, we'd ask it for all the churches, both here in the Inland Empire as well as around the planet that are preaching and hearing the gospel. We bless them, Lord, as you would bless us, God. We thank you for the diversity in the body of Christ, Lord. And if they're lifting up your name, preaching your truth, God, we ask for your favor and your blessing upon them this day. God, also, we pray for our city. We pray for those that are hurting and confused and lost right now, God. We ask, Lord, that you would bring healing and hope through our Lord Jesus Christ to this dying land, God. We pray, Father God, that you would wrap the everlasting arms around us, God. Around all of those who were involved, God, we pray, Lord, for each and every one of the victims and their families, God, those that lost loved ones this past Wednesday, God, we pray that you would uphold them, God, that you would just share your care with them, God, and Lord, may they know your presence during this difficult time, Lord, as well for those that are fighting for their lives in critical condition, God, in the ICU, Lord, we pray, Father God, for their healing, complete and total restoration, God. We pray, Father God, for deliverance for those who are traumatized by these events. May there be no post-traumatic stress, God, or any negative or ill effects on their lives, God, but may they be able to move forward without fear. And God, we thank you and we praise you for it. Lord, we love you and we declare your goodness this day. In Jesus' mighty name, we're all in agreement and we say,
amen.
Amen. Well, today, like I mentioned, it's a Christmas message. And we're going to be taking a sidestep from Hebrews. That being said, I want you to open your Bibles to the book of Hebrews. As I was meditating on the word, I was just listening to the heart of the Holy Spirit and just finding out some things from God about what to talk about today. And as I was, I saw something in the word of God. And today, I believe that you're going to see something as well. Today, the title of the message is The Announcement of Christ. The Announcement of Christ. Hebrews 11 chapter, verse number 23, we see something here in the word of God. Hebrews chapter 11, verse 23 starts out and it says, by faith. Everybody say, by faith.
By faith.
All of Hebrews 11 is about faith. We learned what faith is and how it comes, how we operate in faith, how the great men and women of God throughout history operated by faith. And now we come to this section in Hebrews 11 chapter, verse number 23, and it says, by faith, Moses, when he was born, was hidden 3 months by his parents. So really, this isn't about the faith of Moses. This is about the faith of Moses' parents. Why did they have this faith? Look at this. Because they saw. Everybody say they saw.
They saw.
They saw something beyond the natural. They saw something in faith. And because they saw something, they did something. Because they saw he was a beautiful child, and they were not afraid of the king's command. Now, notice that they saw that Moses was a beautiful child, so they hid him for 3 months. Now, that term being a beautiful child doesn't mean that he was just handsome in appearance. It really means that they saw beyond the natural to the supernatural. And they looked at their son Moses, and they saw that he had a call of God on his life. They saw that the favor of God was upon him. And because they saw something beyond the natural, they were moved with godly fear, not being afraid of the king's command, and they hid him for 3 months in their house. Now, Acts chapter 7 actually gives us more of the story. If you take a look at it in Acts, turn there with me. Right after the gospel, you find the book of Acts, Matthew, Mark, Luke, John, and then you find Acts chapter number 7. Acts chapter 7, verse number 17, talks about these same events. Let's take a look at it together. Acts chapter 7, verse number 17, it says, but when the time of the promise drew near. Now remember, we've been talking about how God gave a promise to Abraham, to Isaac, and to Jacob. And even though God promised them that they would inherit the land, none of them saw that promise in their lifetime. They all died in faith, believing God at his word, and yet never received the promises here on earth. So now we see in the book of Acts, when the time of the promise drew near, God is about ready to do something on the earth. And it says, which God had sworn to Abraham, the people grew and multiplied in the promised land? No, in Egypt. Right? Joseph and his family had gone down to Egypt. There was a time of famine. And so now all of the patriarchs have gone down to Egypt, and they are growing and they are multiplying there. Verse 18 says, till another king arose who did not know Joseph. Verse number 19. This man, this king, dealt treacherously with our people and oppressed our forefathers, making them expose their babies so that they might not live. In fact, the Egyptians enslaved the children of Israel, put them to hard labor. And because they were growing so strong, they made a decree that any child that was born that was a male would be put to death immediately after his birth. It was in this time, it was during these challenges, it was during this horrible, horrific events that God is about ready to bring about a promise. Take a look at it in the next verse, verse number 20. It says, at this time of tragedy, at this time of sorrow, at this time of hurting, it was at this time Moses was born and was well-pleasing to God. That word well-pleasing to God literally means the same thing that we saw in Hebrews 11, chapter verse number 23, that he was a beautiful child. See, they saw something beyond the natural, and they saw to the supernatural that he was well-pleasing to God, that God had a plan for this baby's life. And look at what it says. He was well-pleasing to God and was brought up in his father's house for 3 months. Now, you know the rest of the story. It goes on. We find that after they couldn't hide the child any longer, he's starting to grow, starting to get older, starting to make noise, starting to run around, okay? And they say, we can't hide him any longer. And so therefore, what do? They take that little pitch and that and those sticks together, and they craft a little basket, really like a little ark. And they place their baby in the ark, and they entrust him to the care of Almighty God. Now, you know the story. He floats down the river. Maybe you've seen the movie with Charlton Heston back in the day, or you saw the cartoon more recently, or one of the new Bible stories. And here he goes floating down the river. Maybe you read it in your Bible, too. That's a great place to learn this story. And so he floats down the river, and who picks him up but Pharaoh's daughter? And for 40 years, there he's raised in Pharaoh's house. He learns the ways of Egypt and the way that the royal family lives. And it comes a time where he sees the oppression of his brethren, and he knows that he's different. He knows that he is a part of the nation of Israel. And he sees the oppression of his brethren, and he goes and he murders an Egyptian and buries him in the sand. Next day he's walking along, he sees two Israelites, and they're in a scuffle, they're in a fight, and he tries to stop them. They say, who made you judge over us? Are you going to try and kill us like you did the Egyptian? Fear grips Moses' heart, and he flees and he runs away out to the desert. He becomes a shepherd, wandering in the wilderness for 40 years. I believe he was getting training for what he was going to do, for the call of God that was on his life, because he knew that land like the back of his hand, and he knew how to survive. And therefore, not only as a military leader in Egypt, but now also as a shepherd who could lead others through wilderness places now, he prepares and he is trained until he has an encounter with God at a burning bush. Pretty amazing. Then he goes and he delivers the children of Israel. We see that any time God is doing something on the earth, in the fullness of time, when God is about ready to bring about his promises on the earth, that the devil starts to do something. Just like he started murdering babies in Egypt, we see the same thing at the birth of Christ. You're there in the book of Acts, turn with me to the book of Matthew. Matthew chapter number 2. I told you this was a Christmas message, right? Here we go. Matthew chapter 2. Matthew chapter 2, you know the story. The wise men come. They see the star in the east. They start following it. They show up in Jerusalem. They go to Herod and all the leaders, and they say, hey, where is the one who is born king of the Jews? Now, Herod didn't like this. He wanted to be the only king. Didn't want any other kings rising up and taking his place. And so everybody is troubled at their saying. And so Herod asks the leaders about this, and they say, hey, he's not going to be born in Jerusalem. He's going to be born in Bethlehem. And so Herod sends them to Bethlehem and says, go search for the child diligently until you find him. And when you find him, bring back word to me so that I can go worship him. Now, he was lying to them because really what he wanted to do was murder this child so that he wouldn't take his place. See, the devil will always try and stop the promises of God. So here the wise men come, they present their gifts, they worship, and then being warned, they don't go back to Herod, but they go back home another way. Now look at this in Matthew, the second chapter, verse number 16. Look at what it says. It says, "Then Herod, when he saw that he was deceived by the wise men, was exceedingly angry, and he sent forth and put to death all the male children who were in Bethlehem and in all its districts from 2 years old and under, according to the time which he had determined from the wise men." Now we look at this and we say, that's terrible. That's awful. In fact, Jeremiah prophesied about this, and he said that the voice of wailing is heard, Rachel weeping for her children, and she will not be consoled. These were terrible times, terrible things taking place. And there were probably a lot of people like us this past Wednesday asking, where is God? What's God doing? Why, God? What's happening? This can't be real. And yet when God is about ready to bring a promise on the earth, the devil will always raise his head and try and stop the promises of God. But yet the questions still come. Maybe you saw the news reports. The world is asking the same questions. And they're saying in the New York Daily News, God isn't fixing this. Shaming people who are praying at this time. Your prayers aren't doing anything. Falling on deaf ears. God's not taking care of the guns. God's not fixing the gun control laws. God's not fixing the problem. Can I tell you something? God is not interested in fixing gun control laws. God is interested in saving souls, changing hearts, taking care of eternal realities for each and every one of us. That's what God is interested in. And God already sent the answer 2,000 years ago. There is a solution, and I'm here to tell it to you today. Jesus is the answer. He always has been. He always will be. When the questions arise, where is God? God is in his Son, Jesus Christ, giving us the answer. He's there. Jesus is the solution. See, if Jesus can get into the heart and if he can change the life and recreate who we are so that we're born again, you don't need gun control laws. You need Jesus. He will transform you and live his life in and through you. Not just teaching you about love, but loving others through your life. Jesus is the answer. You know, we see this in the birth announcement of Christ. You're there in Matthew, the second chapter. Turn me to Luke, the second chapter. Luke, the second chapter, very familiar section of Scripture. Luke chapter number 2. Maybe you've read this every year of your life at Christmas time, talking about the shepherds and what took place on the night that Christ was born. We sang about it tonight, this morning. Luke chapter 2. Today, as we read this, I want you to see beyond the natural, see beyond what you've read every year. See beyond the Charlie Brown Christmas where Linus steps up to the mic and starts reciting this, okay? Because we all know this, we've all heard this, we've all read this, but today I want to point out some things that we, like Moses' parents, can see beyond the beauty of eloquent words and scriptures and Christmas cards and all that kind of stuff and see into the supernatural reality of what God is speaking to us. Luke chapter number 2, starting in verse number 8, it says, "Now they were in the same country, shepherds living out in the fields, keeping watch over their flocks by night. And behold, an angel of the Lord stood before them, and the glory of the Lord shone around them, and they were greatly afraid." Now, I don't know about you, but if I was out there in the middle of the night, keeping watch over some sheep, and all of a sudden an angel showed up with the glory of the Lord about him, I might need a change of clothes. Hello. Verse number 10, "Then the angel of the Lord said to them, 'Do not be afraid. For behold, I will bring you good tidings of great joy, which will be to all people.'" That's a pretty amazing statement right there. He says to all people, not just to the Jews, not just to the shepherds and the outcasts, the down and out, the poor, not just to the wealthy and the rich, the educated, the smart and the pretty and the nice, not just to the Middle East, not just to Europe, not just to Asia, not just to Africa, not just to Australia, not just to America, not just to the boomers, but also for the Gen Xers and for the millennials, not just to the ones who were raised in church, but to the nuns and the people who had no religion growing up all their life. This child is born and is great news to all people. Doesn't matter if you're brown or black or white, you have something that's been given to you. The good news of the gospel of Jesus Christ. Look at what he says. "For there is born to you." Look at that. Jesus is for you. And you, and you, and you, and you, and you. See, when you read this, you can say, Jesus born to me. If I was the only one on earth, Jesus still would have been born, and he would have come, and he would have lived, and he would have died for me if I was the only one. That's pretty amazing. God loves you so much. Bible tells us, for the joy that was set before him, Jesus went to the cross and endured its shame. He saw your face there on the cross. There is born to you this day in the city of David a Savior who is Christ the Lord. Christ means Messiah, the anointed one of God. He is the one whom the favor of God rested on. He is the chosen one who is the promise of God who had come into the earth. Verse number 12, and this will be a sign to you. You will find a babe wrapped in swaddling cloths, lying in a manger. Verse number 13, and suddenly there was with the angel a multitude of the heavenly host praising God. Now I wouldn't need another change of clothes at this time because, man, the one angel was enough, but now you got the whole heavenly host showing up. My goodness. Saying, verse number 14, glory to God in the highest, and on earth, peace, goodwill toward men. Now we've heard these words. And we've seen them in the natural, seen them on Christmas cards, seen them on displays, sung songs about them every year of our lives. And yet today, we need to see beyond the natural into the supernatural. Because there's something that comes with the announcement of Christ. When we start to declare, see, because you can't see it without doing something about it. Hello? Just like Moses' parents, they could not see something on Moses without doing something about it. And if you, by faith, see something, you're going to have to do something about it. Why? Because you see it. You understand it by faith. It's spiritually discerned. And now I see it. Therefore, I'm going to do something about it. Just as we see in this announcement of Christ, we also shall declare with our lives and declare with our mouths that Jesus Christ is Lord. There is born to you this day Christ, the Savior, who is the Lord of all. First thing that we see is this. That the announcement of Christ casts out fear. Think about it, and every time you find that there was an announcement, Jesus coming, some of the first words that the angels declared to Joseph in the dream, do not be afraid, Joseph. Do not be afraid to take to you Mary, your wife, for she will conceive of the Holy Spirit and bear a child, and you shall call his name Jesus, for he will deliver his people. When the angels talked to the shepherd, we just saw it, do not be afraid. When the angels were talking to Zacharias in the temple, do not be afraid. When the angel greeted Mary, blessed are you, highly favored of women. And she was concerned and considered this greeting in her heart. What does the angel say to her? Do not be afraid. See, with the announcement of Christ, it casts out all fear. This past Wednesday when we were on lockdown, I started to text my wife, tell her, hey, we're on lockdown. There's active shooter, stuff's going on. You need to just stay home. Don't come down. At 3:30, they released our children from the schools, and they allowed the parents to come and pick them up. My wife was driving down. It was at that same time that the police were pursuing the SUV, and they went right past her car. All these sirens, all stuff going on all around her. My wife had fear come on her, and the very first words out of her mouth were, in the name of Jesus, and all fear was cast out at that moment. See, when you start to declare that Jesus is come, that Jesus is Lord. In the middle of the night when you're crying, when you're concerned, maybe you live in a rough area and guns blazing is a normal thing for you. I understand. I've grown up in rough areas as well. Slept through most of it because I'm a hard sleeper. Praise the Lord. But if you're ever afraid in the middle of the night and you hear things happening, you're wondering what's going on, you can declare in the name of Jesus and cast that fear out. In the doctor's office, when you're getting your checkup and they start to say, well, hey, we're very concerned about this, you can say, in the name of Jesus, I'm not concerned. I will not allow fear to grip me over this. When you see the bills and all the mail come and you spread it out in front of you and start wondering how I'm going to make it, and fear starts to grip your heart, you can say, in the name of Jesus, my God shall supply all of my needs according to his riches and glory by Christ Jesus. Now, Lord, help. Show me how to steward this properly, God. Give me the wisdom and give me the provision. See, you can cast out fear. You don't have to walk in fear. Very familiar psalm in Psalm chapter number 23. Turn there with me. Most of the time when you hear this psalm, it's on a movie. Somebody died, the hero, somebody close to him, you know. And they're reading this out. It's always raining. Have you noticed that? Always raining. They got umbrellas up. Everybody's wearing sunglasses. Why are they wearing sunglasses in the rain? I don't know. Psalm 23, verse number 4, look at what it says. It says, yes, though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death. I mean, you know, that's not a nice valley to be walking through. And yet all the time we walk through it, this past year, I heard a report in our nation that they define a mass shooting as any time there's more than two people involved that are hurt or that are fatally wounded. In the United States of America, there have been this year over 350 mass shootings in our nation alone. That means that there is almost one a day. How scary the times that we're living in. See, and the more we listen to the news reports, the more we look at what's happening around the world, fear can grip our hearts. We are walking through the valley of the shadow of death. And yet, look at what he says. Even though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil. How can you say something like that? What are you, burying your head in the sand? You don't know what's going on? Are you choosing to ignore it and be stupid? No, look at what he says. He says, for you are with me. Who's with him? Jesus. Who's with him? God Almighty. Who's with him? The one who came, who was declared, who was announced, Christ Jesus, the Lord, Emmanuel, God with us. And if you're born in the Spirit of God, it doesn't matter what you go through. It doesn't matter what happens to you. Did you know that we had law enforcement? We had people that go to this church that were in the line of fire. You know that we had people from this church that were in the room when guns started blazing that just met us in the foyer right after church and were able to hug us and tell us of the amazing thing God had done. They saw bullets flying, they saw the shooters, they saw everything taking place all around them, and yet, though they walked through the valley of the shadow of death, they fear no evil. Why? Because God is with them. Now look at what it goes on to say. I will fear no evil, for you are with me. Your rod and your staff, they comfort me. Now, think about this for a second. That shows that the Lord is our shepherd, right? We shall not want. See, the shepherd had two items that he carried with him, many more, in fact. It's a fascinating study. But these two items that he points out here, the rod. What is the rod? The rod is a rod that if the devil comes sniffing around like a wolf, wanting to tear you to pieces, trying to devour you, the shepherd pulls out that rod and he's going to handle his business. Hello, come on, somebody. I thought I came to church in San Bernardino today. He's going to handle. You don't touch my sheep. Right? Don't come sniffing around here, devil. He'll knock him out. Drag him out. He defeated him at the cross. The devil is a defeated foe. That's why when you stay close to the shepherd, you know that you're safe. Some of you guys like sheep have wandered off, and what does God do? He takes out the staff. You know what the staff, the shepherd's crook, you seen that with the big, you know what he's doing? He's pulling you back to himself. No, don't wander over there. It's not safe over there. Come over here. What is he doing? He sees that you might be taking a little nibble of some grass going off over towards a cliff. No, you're not going that way. You're going to come over here. You might be headed into a wilderness, into a desert that's not safe for you, and he'll start to direct you and bring you back. See, the closer you stay to the shepherd, the less fear you'll have in your life. Why? Because the announcement of Christ casts out fear. You've got to see it, though. Can't be looking at the news reports. Can't be looking at the world around you. Can't be looking at the times and things getting darker and darker. The Bible told us it would be bad and would get worse. And yet, I don't look at those things in the natural. I look to the supernatural in faith, like Moses' parents, and I see that I will fear no evil because God is with me. The announcement of Christ casts out all fear. What else? What else? When we announce Christ, when we declare Jesus is Lord, what happens? Well, secondly is that the announcement of Christ brings peace. Jesus is the Prince of Peace. It's awesome when we start to declare Jesus that we have the peace of God. You know, fear is one thing, but you can be unafraid and yet still have cares and concerns and weights and worries that are on your life. You might not be in fear, but you may have no peace. Might be disturbed in your thinking. Things going on, and yet when we start to declare, when we start to announce Jesus is Lord, when we start to say that with our lives and with our mouths, all of a sudden the peace of God rests upon it. I heard somebody say that when they were bussed in, some of the evacuees, that as they came on this campus, one of the buses parked and somebody just said, "Oh, thank God we're safe." And then they came into the youth auditorium and we put on some Christian music for them and just had that softly playing in the background. And people said that that music just brought them such peace. I received an email from one of our younger members raised in this church, grew up here. Her dad actually works here as a part of our staff. And she's in college, and she wrote me this email this week, and it says, "A guy from my college class was talking to me about how his mom was one of the victims in yesterday's shooting. He told me how his mom walked to the bathroom minutes before the shooters came to the building. So she locked herself in the bathroom and called the police, where they immediately connected her with the SWAT team, who told her they were outside and would be in the building within 5 minutes. I told him that my dad works at the church and that all the victims were taken to. I told him he was involved in organizing everything to make sure the property was safe for everyone. His face immediately lit up, and he told me to tell my dad and the pastors and staff at The Rock that he and his family are forever grateful for the fact that our church invited the victims in with open arms. He told me that his mom was terrified, and once she walked onto the property, she was overcome with peace. She was glad to have people there to comfort and to pray for her and all of the other victims. I guess that she hadn't eaten since earlier that morning and was also extremely grateful for the food, drinks, and phone chargers that allowed her to get in touch with her family." See, when you announce Jesus Christ, it brings peace. John chapter 14, turn there with me. Back to the Gospels, Gospel of John, chapter number 14. Jesus is speaking, and he makes some amazing statements. Take a look at it with me in John chapter 14, verse number 27. Jesus says these words. He says, "Peace I leave with you. My peace I give to you. Not as the world gives do I give to you. Let not your heart be troubled, neither let it be afraid." Now, I don't know if you've read those words before or not, but take a look at it with me today with eyes of faith. Let's see beyond the natural, and let's see to the supernatural. Look at what he says. He says, "Peace I leave with you." Now, the world would like to say that they have peace. We've got this thing contained. We found the people. We found the house. We found the bombs. We found whatever. The storm has gone. And yet, even though we can have those words in the natural, we still don't have peace. But look at what Jesus says. He says, "Peace I leave with you. My peace I give to you." Now, let me ask you a question. What kind of peace does Jesus have? I would say that's a perfect peace, wouldn't you? Because Jesus is God, therefore, God is perfect. And if Jesus says, "I'm giving you my peace," he's given us the peace of God. Therefore, it's a perfect peace. And it's also a all-sufficient peace. In other words, the peace that Jesus gives us can handle every care, every concern, every worry, every frustration we may ever have. So he says, "My peace I leave with you, I give to you. Not as the world gives do I give to you." See, this is not the way of the world. This is a supernatural thing that Jesus gives to us. The world might give it for a moment and then take it away. Oh, you thought you were safe, but guess what's happening over here? You thought that you could drink coffee, but now you can't. You thought that you could do this and walk over here and be that, but no, you can't. You see, the world will give you false hope. Oh, the market is going up, but now it's crashing. Everything's a roller coaster experience. But Jesus says, "I'm not giving and taking away and giving and taking away. No, my peace I leave with you. My peace I give to you. Not as the world gives do I give to you." So you say, "Pastor Dan, I know that. And if Jesus has done that, why do I still not have peace?" Here's why. One little three-letter word that we see in the first part of the second sentence: let. Jesus said, "Let not your heart be troubled." In other words, it's your call. It's your choice. You can choose to operate in the peace of God by declaring Jesus with your mouth, by announcing Christ, by bringing Jesus into every area of your life. Or you can choose to be troubled, concerned, cares, and then eventually you'll be back to fear because you won't realize and recognize and see beyond the natural that God is with you. It's your choice. It's your call. You can flow in the peace of God. Can you say amen today? Amen. God is good. The announcement of Christ, number one, casts out all fear. Secondly, the announcement of Christ brings peace. And finally, what do we see beyond the natural in the announcement of Christ? We see this. We see, as we announce Christ, that it declares the goodwill of God towards man. Declares the goodness of God. Do you know that God is good? Come on, somebody say all the time. And all the time, God is good. That's right. God is good. Why? Because it's in his nature. He can't be anything other than good. And when you start to declare Jesus Christ, who is God in the flesh now, you start to bring the goodness of God towards man on the earth. You say, well, if God is good and he wants good for us, then why is the bad stuff happening? Because we live in a fallen world and because the devil is very alive as well. And he's at work. But God is working, the Bible says, all things together. That all things means even the bad things, even the trouble, even the trial, even the lack, even the need, even the circumstances, even the terrible things. God is working all things together for what? For good to those that love the Lord and are called according to his purpose. That's you. That's me. God's going to work it out for good. Why? Because he is good. That's why the Bible says God can't lie. Because lying is bad, lying is evil, and God is not bad, nor is he evil. James chapter 1, some of you guys need convincing. Hebrews, right after the book of Hebrews, you'll find the book of James. Turn there with me. James chapter number 1, let's take a look at it in the Bible. James chapter number 1, verse number 17. Great verse, highlight it, underline it, circle it in your Bible. Highlight it with your Bible app, whatever you're doing, make some notes right now so you can find this again. James chapter number 1, verse number 17. Look at what it says. It says, every good gift and every perfect gift is from above. See, God's ways are higher than our ways. His thoughts are higher than our thoughts. And just as the heavens are above the earth, so is God above us. And when we realize that there are good things in our life, those didn't come because of how cool, smart, nice, pretty, wealthy, educated, any of that kind of stuff that we are. They come to us because of how good God is. Every good and every perfect gift is from above and comes down from the Father of lights. See, there's no darkness in God. God is the Father of lights. Look at this. With whom there is no variation or shadow of turning. God has and always will be good. In the Old Testament, many times people say God was angry. You know, God was just looking to destroy people. Do you know that God grieves in the Old Testament? God shares his love in the Old Testament. The Bible calls God in the Old Testament the faithful God who showers his loving kindness on those who love him for 1,000 generations. God is looking to bless. God is good. And God wants to bless us. He wants to bless our lives. And when we announce and declare Jesus is Lord, when we announce the Christ in our lives and we bring God into the equation, all of a sudden we know that it's all going to work out for good. Even though it may have been bad, guess what? God's working behind the scenes. He's going to do something good. I know God is up to something, and God is up to something good because God is good. Jesus Christ is the same yesterday, today, and forever. He has good things. It may not be good now, but God's working it out. God's going to turn it around for something good. I'd like to read you a story before we end today. It's called God's Geese. Isn't that a funny name? But I want to read this to you. It's a Christmas story, and it's a fictional story, okay? So that means it's not real. The man by the name of Bob, he didn't believe much in God and was quick to let anyone know. Maybe your name's Bob here in this place today. His wife, however, was a believer, raised their children to have faith in God. One snowy Christmas Eve, Bob's wife and children pleaded with him to go with them to church. He refused. Christmas is nonsense, he said. Why would God lower himself to come to the earth as a man? So his wife and children left Bob at home. And went to their Christmas church service. A while later, as the wind howled outside, Bob relaxed in front of the fireplace. Suddenly, he heard loud honking noises outside. He looked out the window, but the blinding snow hindered his view. So he went outside to see what was going on. In the field by the barn, Bob found several wild geese that had gotten separated from their flock. They had lost their bearings in the snow and were wandering around aimlessly. Bob knew the geese wouldn't last long in the storm. They needed a shelter where they could stay until the wind and snow stopped. He opened the barn doors and he waited for the geese to go in, but they stayed in the field. Bob got behind the geese and tried to shoo them into the barn, but this only scared them. So Bob thought for a second, and then he went and he ran and he got a bunch of grain. And he started to lay out a trail for the geese all the way into the barn, hoping that they would find it and that they would walk their way into the barn eating the grain. But they stayed nonetheless, still wouldn't go in. All of Bob's efforts to help had failed. He realized the geese would never follow a man. And he thought, if only I were a goose, I could save them. Then he had an idea. He went into the barn and picked up one of his geese. He carried it outside and set it down behind the wild geese. And when he released his goose, it flew straight into the barn, and one by one, the wild geese followed it to safety. He stood silently for a moment, considering what he had just thought. If only I were a goose, I could save them. Then he remembered what he had said earlier to his wife. Why would God lower himself to come to earth as a man? Suddenly, it all made sense. Mankind was like those geese, blind, lost, and perishing. God sent his son to become like us so he could save us. Now Bob understood what Christmas was all about and why Jesus had to come. He saw by faith. Bob fell to his knees in the snow and prayed, "Thank you, God, for coming in human form to get me out of a storm of sin." Today I'm going to ask, before anybody gets up, before anybody leaves this place, I want you to just stay put for a couple more minutes and then we'll let you go. I want a couple more minutes of your attention. Maybe today you came into this place like Bob. Fearful, concerned, worried. Maybe you've been looking around at events around you. Maybe you used to be in church at one time and you backslid and you fell away from God. Today, God is speaking to each and every one of us in this room. And once again, please give me a couple more minutes of your attention. No one get up. No one walk around during this time. Because I want to make sure that if this was your last day on the earth, you know we're not guaranteed tomorrow. We saw that on Wednesday. It's very real to us right now. We are not guaranteed another day on the earth. What if today was our last day? What if somebody broke into those back doors and came in here with a gun? This was our last day on the earth. God forbid that should happen, ever. In the name of Jesus, it won't in this place. But what if? What if today was your last day on the earth? Where would you go? Would you end up in heaven or would you go to hell? Now, sometimes people are offended. They say, well, I don't believe in hell, and that's terrible of you to talk about that right now. But can I tell you something? Let's get real, guys. Would somebody please just stand up and tell us the truth and not play games? Listen, you've had enough smoke blown in your face. You've had enough fog and mirrors. You've had enough people trying sugarcoat things and candy coat things to get you to swallow a bitter pill. But I'm just here to tell you, we're not watering this down. This is the truth. The Bible talks about it, Old and New Testament. Jesus himself spoke about a real heaven and a real hell. And just by burying your head in the sand and saying hell's not real, I don't believe in it, doesn't make it go away. You're going to have to face the reality of it. And I want you to consider your life right now. Where are you at with God? If you were to die today, would you go to heaven or would you go to hell? Sometimes people think, well, you know, I would go to heaven because all roads lead to heaven. Listen, not all roads lead to heaven. Can you think about that statement for a second? What if I told you all roads lead to the moon? You'd look at me and say, you're crazy. You could drive around the earth as long as you want and you'll never make it. Not all roads lead to heaven. Not all roads lead to the moon. And yet, when we apply it to spiritual things, we think it works that way. Do you think God, the creator of the heavens and the earth, the one who wrote the plan of redemption, carried it out in his son, coming in the form of a baby, born in a manger, born in the fullness of time, the promise of God through the ages, living the perfect, spotless, sinless life. Do you think after he does that and goes to the cross that he says, yeah, whatever you want to do, whatever the churches out there want to do, it's fine. Everybody is going to get to go to heaven. Do you think he goes through all of that and doesn't tell us how to get to heaven? He does in his word. Not all roads lead to heaven. Sometimes people think, if I'm just good enough, if I do enough good works, I'll get to heaven. But did you know nowhere in the Bible say just be good and you get to heaven? God is not some jolly old Saint Nick in the heavenlies making a list and checking it twice of who's been naughty and who's been nice. In fact, the Bible tells us that all have sinned and fall short of the glory of God. You're not going to make it to heaven just based on your goodness because you can't be good enough. Sometimes people think, well, maybe if I'm raised in church or if I attend enough church or if I get involved in church, maybe that'll help me out with God. And I've done all those things. I was raised in church. Parents told me we were Christians growing up, not any other religions. You know, I've attended a lot of church. In fact, I'm sitting in church in front of you right now, Pastor. And I've gotten involved in my last church. I sang in the choir, carried the pastor's Bible, made decisions. People thought of me as a leader. But can I share with you something? Nowhere in the Bible say your church attendance, being raised in church, getting involved in church is going to get you into heaven. God's not looking for your membership card to a church before you can enter the gates of heaven. Today, let me love you enough, respect you enough, and honor you enough to tell you the truth. You're not going to make it. So you say, well, Pastor, hold on a second, because I know God. I know about Christmas. I know about the baby in the manger. I could quote the scriptures. I sang the songs every year of my life, celebrate the resurrection at Easter. I know God. Doesn't that mean that I'm a Christian headed for heaven? Well, let me ask you a question. Have you read your Bible? Because the Bible says the demons believe that Jesus Christ is the Son of God. They're not Christians. The Bible says the devil himself knows who Jesus is and can quote scriptures out of his mouth, and yet that doesn't qualify him for heaven. So everybody look up here at me for a second. Look up here. This is not about what you have in your head. Not about having mental assent towards God, knowing who Jesus is, and that gets you all right with God, but rather this is about your heart. God's always been after your heart. And you got to see beyond the natural into the supernatural. Jesus said it like this. He said, you must be born again. Now, I know many times people turn off when they hear that statement, being born again. They say, ugh, seen that in a movie, read about that in a book or on a blog on the internet. And I just don't want to have any part of that. That's weirdo. That's fanatical. That's that crazy Christianity. I don't want to do that. I don't want to be born again. And yet Jesus said, you must. You must be. You want to enter the kingdom of heaven? Which we all do. No one's here saying, yeah, I want to party on in hell. No, that's foolishness. We all want to go to heaven. We all want to be blessed for eternity with the presence of God. So we must be born again if we're going to get there. What does being born again mean? Well, from the beginning of the Bible to the end of the Bible, it's always meant the same thing. It means you've given God all of your heart. And you've given God all of your life. It's just that simple. It's all or nothing with Jesus. In fact, the last book of the Bible, the book of Revelation, Jesus is speaking to a church just like he's speaking to us here in this church today. And he says, when I come, I want to find you hot or I want to find you cold, because if I find you lukewarm, I will vomit you from my mouth. Now, those are pretty gross and graphic words from the mouth of Jesus, but what's he saying? Lukewarm, what's that? Well, it's a little in, little out, little up, little down, little token prayer every now and again, and occasional church attendance. God is something in your life, but he's not everything. You're not opposed to God, but you're not wholehearted for God. Listen, if that's your relationship with Jesus, you're not going to make it. How do I know that? Because only people that are not real Christians will be ejected and rejected from the body of Christ. So today, I'm going to give you an opportunity, just like Bob, to give God all of your heart and to give God all of your life. In a moment, I'm going to count to three just like this. One, two, three, and pop my hands together. Bang! When you hear the sound of my hands popping together just like that, bang! That's your opportunity to raise your hand. What you're doing by the raising of your hand is you're saying, I want to give God all my heart. I want to give God all my life. I want to be born again, headed for heaven, denying my presence in hell. I'll see your hand go up. I'll count it. You put it right back down. You might be thinking, whoa, 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 wait a second. Time out. If I raise my hand, I'll be embarrassed. Yeah, you might be. Let's push past that today. Because think of the trade-off. Isn't it better to be embarrassed for a moment than it is to end up in hell forever and ever and ever? No one make that trade. Moment of possible embarrassment for eternity away from God? Come on. And yet, the devil's going to try and talk you out of this. He's going to whisper in your ears and say, no, it's okay. You're afraid. That's good. Because you should be. You know, this isn't real. It's just fanaticism. It's just emotionalism. He's an opportunist. How dare he take this? How dare he talk about those people like that? How dare he take this time and play with your emotions? Listen, you better believe I'm an opportunist. Devil's out there taking lives. Devil's out there killing people. And I can't stand in a godly church and declare the gospel of Jesus Christ and let you know, look around you and wake up. It's time to give your heart and life to Jesus. We are not assured tomorrow, and that's why I'm in your face today telling you the truth, because I love you, and I don't want you to go to hell. I want you to go to heaven and be blessed by God forever and ever. That's what this is about. Now listen, you probably won't even be embarrassed, okay? But even if you are, it's better than ending up in hell. This is your time. This is your moment. Who should raise their hand if you're not sure about your salvation? Come on, today make sure. Who should raise their hand if you've never done this, never given God all of your heart, never given God all of your life? I'm speaking to you. Who should raise their hand if you've been running from God instead of to God? I'm speaking to you. There's one already. We'll do it all together, okay? Give me one moment. Thank you. God bless you. Who should raise their hand in a moment if you've been running from God instead of to God? I'm speaking to you. Or finally, who should raise their hand if you're lukewarm in this place? You know that's the condition of your heart when I described it. Get ready to get your hands up. Listen, you won't be alone. There's one already that's given their heart and life to Jesus today. Will you now give God all of your heart and all of your life? All across this auditorium, back in the family rooms, wherever you're at, watching by television, hey, God sees you right where you're at. If you're online, across the nation and around the world, get ready to get your hand up. God sees and God knows, and you're making the declaration right where you're at. You can give God all of your heart. You can give God all of your life. If you're in the foyer or down at the Love Rock Cafe on campus right now, hey, get your hand up and then tell an usher right afterwards or come into the church service. I'm going to count to three. Pop my hands together. This is your time. This is your moment of salvation. Here we go, all together on the count of three. One, two, three. Let me see your hands. Just raise them up high for me. If that's you, you need to give God all of your heart and all of your life. There's one, two, three, four. Thank you. God bless you. Who else today? Four, five. Got you right there. Thank you. Five wise people. Six. Got you over there. Thank you. God bless you. Who else today? Need to give God all of your heart and all of your life. There's six. I got you back there. Seven. Thank you. Eight up on top. Got you over there. Thank you. God bless you. Eight wise people already. Anybody else? If I didn't already see it, just put it up high for me. Maybe give me a little wave if I didn't see you yet. And you're saying, yeah, I really want to do this. I want to give God all my heart. I want to give God all my life. Listen, I didn't embarrass them and I won't embarrass you. Anybody else? Real quick. I want to give you an opportunity. Come on, number 9, number 10, number 11, number 12. You're sitting there wondering if you should do this? Yeah. Yeah, you should. Go for it. Come on. Come on. This is your day. This is your time. This is your moment. Anybody else? We've got eight wise people already. If that's you, just lift it up high. Thank you, number 9. God bless you. Who else today? Don't you just feel number 10? Come on, number 10. Sitting there, hearts beating out of your chest, and you're going, man, I know I need to do this. You've been waiting. Listen, God's calling you out right now. If that's you, just lift it up high, okay? Anybody else real quick? Come on, thank you, number 10. Anybody else? Anybody else? Thank you, number 11. Oh, number 12. Come on, I said 12, right? Didn't I? Come on, let's go. Complete the dozen. Anybody else? Number 12, number 13. We got a baker's dozen today. Come on, let's give the Lord a great big praise. Hallelujah. Woo! Snuck in there at the end. God is so good. Hey, here's what I want to do. I want to pray with you. I want to lead you in a prayer to invite Jesus in your heart, okay? I want to change destinies with you today. Can't do that till we get you down here. So in a moment, we're all going to stand. No one leave during this time. We're trying to get them to come this way. If you go that way, they'll follow you that way, okay? Send them this way, all right? If you raised your hand, you should have raised your hand. Once you get a hold of your coat, purse, sweater, Bible, a friend if you need a friend, once you get in the aisle and meet me up front, we're going to change destinies. From the family rooms, if your children raise their hand, bring them. They'll remember this. From the foyer, if you're out there, come on into the church service right now. Let's all stand and welcome them. And if you raised your hand or you should have raised your hand, you come right now. Come on down to the front. Come on, come on, come on, come on.
Jesus, I believe.
Hallelujah, they're coming. Let's give them a hand.
Jesus, I belong.
You can come too. This is your time. This is your moment of salvation. Anybody else, if you need to come, just come on down right now. Nudge your neighbor, say, come on, friend. I'll go with you. Come on, come on, come on.
Jesus, I believe.
Wow. Wow. Look at you guys. Look at you guys. If you still need to come while I'm talking, you can still come, okay? So come on down. Hey, you guys. Great, great, great. Best decision of your life. I'm so excited for you right now. I'm going to lead you in a prayer to invite Jesus into your heart. You're going to be born again like we talked about. Brand new, okay? On the inside, okay? So everybody's going to join in with you right now. Now, listen, I'm going to lead you in a prayer. I'll go slow. I'll make some statements. I want you to repeat them out loud. Now, if you mess up on some of the words, that's okay. This isn't a formula. This isn't magical abracadabra words. This is you giving your heart and life to Jesus, okay? So we're all going to do this together. Let's all bow our heads. Let's close our eyes. And I want you to say these words out loud to God from your heart. Say, Father God, I come to you now in Jesus' name. And I give you all of my heart and all of my life. Come into my heart. Be my Lord and my Savior. Forgive me of all I've done wrong. Wash me with your blood. Cleanse me of my sin. Give me a brand new heart and a brand new start. Today, I declare that Jesus is my Lord and my Savior. That I am a Christian. I'm headed for heaven. Deny my presence in hell. Thank you, Jesus. Fill me now with your Holy Spirit. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen. Come on, let's give the Lord a great big praise. Hallelujah. Woo. Awesome. 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 Okay, you guys, now that you're a Christian, you need to find out what to do next. And so we want to help you with that. Right over here is my friend, Pastor Joel, in the denim jacket. Really good guy. Nothing weird goes on. You know, sometimes you go to church, you wonder, are they weird? I'm about as weird as you're going to encounter today. Okay, he's cool. He's going to give you some free information, some free literature, find out what to do next in your walk with God. Now that I'm a Christian, what do I do? Okay, little booklet, help you to read, find out what to do next. And then secondly, he's going to introduce you to a friend we have here in the church that we call a spiritual personal trainer. Heard of a physical trainer? The gym helps you get strong, right? Get buff like me. Why are you guys laughing? That's not even nice, okay? Spiritual personal trainer will do that for you spiritually, okay? He'll describe how it works, then he'll let you come right back out. Your friends and family will wait for you. So if you guys make a left turn, follow Pastor Joel right this way. Love you, Pastor Joel. Come on, let's give the Lord a great big praise today. Woo!
Hey, you just heard that altar call. You just wanted to give God all of your heart and all of your life. Now let me lead you simply in a prayer of inviting Jesus Christ into your heart as your Lord and Savior. In fact, why don't you just go ahead and listen to me and go ahead and close your eyes and just repeat these words after me. I'll go slow. You repeat them. Say these words. Say, Father God, I come to you in the name of Jesus. I believe that Jesus Christ is your only begotten Son, and that you sent him for me, and that he died for me on that cross at Calvary. I believe that his blood washes away my sins, that I am now a new creature in Christ Jesus. And I thank you, Lord. I receive you now and forever as my Lord and as my Savior. I'm going to turn from sin, and I'm going to turn with all of my heart and all of my life to you, Jesus, as my Lord and as my Savior. Let it be known in heaven as well as upon the earth that I am born again. I'm a child of God, that I'm saved, and I'm headed for heaven and denying my presence in hell. Thank you, Jesus. I'm alive forevermore. Love you so much. God bless you guys. Everybody just say amen and receive Christ as your Lord and Savior. So talk to you later. God bless you. Bye-bye.